Hello student, I am Professor A.V. Brahmane. Today we will start our unit number 2. Dear student, if you remember, we already completed unit number 1. The name of the unit number 1 is Introduction to HPC. In that unit number 1, we discuss about scope of parallelism, then motivation to parallelism, trends in microprocessor architecture, memory system performance. We discuss about network topology, physical organization of parallel random access machine. We discuss about communication cost of parallel machines and many more things. Why I repeat these things? Because after unit number 1, we come to know that what is high performance computing and what is parallel computing. Now, in unit number 2, today we will start parallel programming. What are the contents of unit number 2? Student, the unit number 2 contains introduction to parallel algorithms, in that task and decomposition, process and mapping, process versus processor, decomposition techniques, 4 decomposition techniques. First one is recursive decomposition. Next one is speculative decomposition, exploratory decomposition, hybrid decomposition. This one is the speculative decomposition. Third article, characteristics of task and interaction. Under that, task generation, granularity, and context, characteristics of task interaction. Then there are mapping techniques for load balancing, methods for minimizing interaction overheads, and then parallel algorithm design model. So this particular unit is giving us many more things about high performance and parallel programming. So this is the first article of unit number 2, that is preliminary decomposition task and dependency graph. The first step in developing a parallel algorithm is to decompose the problem into tasks that can be executed concurrently. So what do you mean by this? Decomposition means breaking down the big system into smaller tasks. So every problem we have to decompose into number of subtasks. That is nothing but decomposition. A given problem may be decomposed into tasks in different ways. A task may be of same, different, or even intermediate size. A decomposition can be illustrated in the form of directed graph with nodes corresponding to tasks and edges, indicating that the result of one task is required for processing the next. Such a graph is called as task dependency graph. So see here, once we decompose the big problem into different subtasks, then we can design or we can draw a task dependency graph. Now whatever the subtask we have formed, that may be of same size, that may be of different size, or that may be of intermediate size. So after that task dependency graph, that is a directed graph, and the nodes of that graph are nothing but the task, and the edges of that graph is nothing but how the task is communicated with other tasks. So that is a task dependency graph. Now take one example. Multiplying dense matrix with vector. As shown in this slide, a dense matrix, what do you mean by dense? Now the dense matrix, this concept is nothing but means we come across 3x3 matrix, 5x5 matrix, 2x5 matrix, but when the number of rows and the number of column of the matrix is more or big in number, if they are 1000x1000, 1000 rows are multiplied with 1000 columns, then such type of matrix is called as dense matrix. So in a parallel programming, many times we come across a big calculation. So this is a good example of such a big calculation or complex calculation where a big matrix is multiplied with the vector. So that's why it is called as a dense matrix multiplication with vector. So here it is shown that the rows of the matrix are decomposed into task 1, task 2, task 3, task 4, and task n. So number of tasks are created. That is called as a decomposition. Decomposition is the very important step where a problem is decomposed into subtasks. So this matrix is decomposed into task 1, task 2, and task n. Okay. So computation of each element of output vector y is independent of another element. So that means now you can see here task 1, so entire row is multiplied with a vector b to get the first element of the resultant vector y. Similarly, if I multiply the second task of this matrix with the entire element of the b vector, then I get the second element of the resultant vector. So this means that the computation of each element of output vector y is independent of other element. So based on this, a dense matrix vector product can be decomposed into n tasks. The figure highlights the portion of matrix and the vector accessed by task 1. Now, what are the observations from this figure or from this slide? While the tasks share data, namely the vector b, they do not have any control dependencies. That is, no task needs to wait for the partial completion of any other task. All tasks are of same size in the term of number of operations. So is this the maximum number of tasks we will decompose this problem into? So this is the observation from this slide. So dear students, in this example, we decompose the matrix into n rows and we form the n tasks. And then now we are multiplying that each task independently with the vector element to get the resultant vector. This is nothing but a vector matrix vector multiplication example. This is a very good example, and you keep in mind this example because later on also in our subject or in our syllabus, we will come across this example. Now, consider the example of database query processing. Here, consider the execution of the query, that is a model equal to CVEC and year equal to 2001 and color equal to green or color equal to white. Now, in a big organization, in a big database, okay, where a car manufacturing company is there like Maruti Suzuki or Hyundai or many car manufacturing companies are there. So their database is big. Now here one database is given where the ID of the model name, the year of manufacturing, the color of the car, the dealer and the price of the car is given. And now I want to extract a particular car whose model is Civic and whose year of manufacturing is 2001 and color of the car is green or color of the car is white. If this is my database query, then I can form a task dependency graph based on this query, because this is the task, this is my problem. Now I want to decompose that problem into different subtasks. So how many subtasks I can form? So you can see here the execution of the query can be divided into subtasks in various ways. Each task can be thought of as a generating an intermediate table of entries that satisfy the particular clause. Now you can see here model, then year, color are the three different activities that we required for our query satisfaction. So I have framed this task dependency graph as per this four subtasks. So this is the big problem that is decomposed into model, year of manufacturing, color. Now you can see here, whenever I form the model subtable, then I come across all the model and its ID. And whenever I form the year subtable, then I come across the year of manufacturing and the ID and the color and ID, and same thing for another color, that is green, and its ID. So now you can see here, decomposing the given query into number of tasks, edges in this graph denote that the output of one task is needed to accomplish the next task. So this is a task dependency graph for our previous problem. So this is our problem, and we can draw a task dependency graph for this problem. Now you can see here, initially, now from this table we can get the civic color. From this table we can get the year of manufacturing 2001. From this we got the white color, and from this green color. Now you can perform the union operation, and we can get the combination of this green and white color in one separate table. Similarly, the model and the year into separate table, and finally all these are integrated to satisfy our query. And this query is nothing but model is equal to civic and year is equal to 2000 and color is equal to green or color is equal to white. So this is a way to solve the problem by using task dependency graph. Now, same problem of database query example can be solved in another way also. Note that the same problem can be decomposed into subtasks in another way. Now you can see here, the four subtasks are found out here, same to the previous problem, and then how they are integrated. Initially, the white color and the green color are combined together to form this table. The color table then combined with the year of manufacturing, and finally color year, this table is integrated with a model to satisfy this query. So alternate decomposition of the given problem into subtasks along with their data dependency is shown here. So there may be different task dependency graph for same problem, but no doubt about that, or keep in mind that our first and foremost activity is to decompose the problem into subtasks. And the tasks which are generated that may be of same size, different size, or intermediate size, that is very important. Now, this is the first article where I would like to tell you about the preliminaries of the decomposition, that how we can decompose the problem. Okay. Now there are decomposition techniques. In a unit number, in a second article, we will discuss about task generation, task, then task dependency graph, task interaction graph is also there, and then the granularity is there, decomposition methods are there, many more things are there. Till today, this is sufficient that what is unit number two. Unit number two is parallel programming, and in that we started decomposition. Decomposition is dividing the big problem into different subtasks. The task may be of same size, different size, or intermediate size. This example, multiplying the matrix with vector, and the database query example are both important example for understanding decomposition. So I hope that you will understand what is meant by decomposition. In the next lecture, we will see our another article of unit number two. Till then, thank you very much. Goodbye.